Amen. What a wonderful way of beginning our time together. Welcome everyone at home. We believe that no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, even if you're still at home, even if you're still in bed or on the couch or who knows where you are, you're welcome here. We love you, we miss you, and we hope everyone is staying healthy and well. I have a few announcements to begin with, and that is Monday, November 16th, is People's Kitchen, and we're serving a whole Thanksgiving meal, turkey and mashed potatoes and everything else, because everyone deserves to have a Thanksgiving feast around Thanksgiving time. And if you would like to help with turkeys or pumpkin bars, those are the big needs right now, please call Sally if you can help with either one of those items. Yes, thank you, Sally. Also, we are looking for assistance helping on Sunday mornings with live streaming the service. Tim has been doing this every week, and Kenny has been helping with the audio. Our faithful, faithful friends, they shouldn't be the only ones to help with this. And if you would like to help live streaming on Sundays, we can train you. And we can show you how to push all the buttons and all that stuff. So think about it. And also, the church is needing someone to serve as a secretary and someone to serve as treasurer for this upcoming year. So if you have been in covenant with us for at least a year and think this is something that you might want to do, let us know and we will and we'll talk about it. Let's see, I have one more item to share, and that is 2 weeks from today is the San Luis Obispo Ministerial Association Interfaith Thanksgiving Service. This has been going on over 40 years in our community. And it is folks from different faith traditions coming together to just be grateful for who is in our life and for all the things that we're grateful for. You know, Thanksgiving is something that really connects folks in the interfaith community because no one can say, oh yes, that's my holiday. You know, it's not like Easter, which is Christian, or Rosh Hashanah, which is Jewish. Like, no one owns Thanksgiving. So we can all come together and express gratitude. This year it's going to be on Zoom so that we can keep each other safe and healthy. And the Zoom link was in the Chronicle, and we'll also be emailing it so that folks can join. And every year we receive an offering for our friends at Restorative Partners, 40 Prado, the Knorr Clinic, and Stand Strong. So think about, that'll be on the 15th at 3 o'clock in the afternoon via Zoom. That is all of my announcements for the time being. So let's turn now to our gratitudes. If you have someone or something to be grateful for and would like to share it, share it either in the comment section or if you happen to be here in real life this morning, you're welcome to share something that is filling your heart with gratitude. I will start off by saying how happy I was for the extra hour of sleep this morning. There is an extra spring in my step this morning. I've only had one cup of coffee, so this is natural, folks. This is sleep. Praise God. We should do this more often. No more time changes. Also, this day, All Saints Day, is Stephen and I's 6th anniversary. We got married. Yeah. We got married November 1st, 2014. Our good friend, Rich Karash, officiated the wedding for us, and it was a really special day. We've been together 6 years legally, and I like to say 14 years illegally. So it's a special day for us. It's also special because it's All Saints Day. So that is what is filling my heart with gratitude this morning. And if anyone else has something you'd like to share, raise a hand. Yes, Leslie.
We had a lovely couple of days away to celebrate Heather's birthday.
Yay! Wonderful. Any other gratitudes? Yes, Diane.
Well, this being November, this is also our anniversary month, so that'll be coming up on the 19th.
Happy anniversary, you two.
We've been together since 76.
76? That's 44 years.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Legally since 83.
I gotcha. Lots of couples have two anniversaries, a legal one and an illegal one. That's how it goes these days. Any other gratitudes or joys before we move on to one of the greatest gratitudes that I have is welcoming folks into covenant with this congregation. And we have 10 folks who are going to join us in our mission to love and to serve in Jesus' name. And so I'm going to invite first Amy Brantley and Shell Voorhees to come up. And I'm going to stand just a little bit this way so that we have 6 feet. If you would like to take your masks off, you're welcome to do that, just so everyone has a good look at you. All right. Yay! So let me share a little bit about Amy and Shell. Amy is to my immediate, is that my right? I get so turned around. Is to my immediate right, and then Shell is on my far right. They have lived in the area for 2 years, but Amy has been visiting visiting the Central Coast since she was a toddler, and they moved from Fresno 2 years ago. Amy's interests include the arts, and she loves painting and pottery. We have so many artistic folks in our congregation. What brought Amy to our church? Well, the short answer is the sign. That's a hard-working sign, y'all. Amy has a deep affection for Lucille Ball. She appreciates a good drag performance. She loves the romanticized version of the 1950s, and she loves Polynesian everything. So welcome, Amy. And then Shell's interests include pottery and watching sports, either live or on TV. And what brought Shell to our church? Well, the Brantley family, Dan, Kay, and Amy. Dan and Kay searched for a church once they all moved here from Fresno, and they went to a couple of others, and then they saw the sign out front of UCC SLO on Los Osos Valley Road, and they knew that they had to try it out. Well, they were sold on the church, the people, and the pastor. She went with the Brantleys a couple of times and felt at home here. And then COVID hit, and she started going to church on Facebook every Sunday. She's looking forward to coming back in person to church. She thinks that she and Amy might have to alternate Sundays at the shop now. By the way, they own Ugly Mug Ceramics in Morro Bay, which is just a few blocks away from Top Dog Coffee. So I tell you, that's a great block to spend some time. And then one thing you might not know about Shell, she played Division I softball at Fresno State for 4 years, from 1982 to 1985, and she was a catcher. So, welcome, Amy and Shell. Welcome. All right, you may be seated, and then let's send up Dan and Kay. Welcome you two, and feel free to remove your mask if you would like. So I will start with Dan here to my immediate right. Dan and Kay have lived here for 2 years. Dan's interests and hobbies include gardening, travel, and making Christmas ornaments for the shop. And can I tell you, he has been busy lately. I have seen him painting there in the back. Dan was looking for a church that accepted everyone, and he likes the people here. I do too. Dan enjoys classic cars and gets really seasick. Good to know. Good to know. Don't go on a boat with Dan. And then Kay on my far right has been coming to Morro Bay since the early 70s because her mom had a little beach bungalow in Morro Bay, and they tried to come as often as they could. And they moved here 2 years ago, full-time, in November of 2018, and Kay said it sure beats shoveling snow at Shaver. I bet that is true. Kay likes to travel. Kauai is the best. I agree. She likes to tinker around and shop. And what brought Kay to the church? Well, the sign, of course. And then once they came to check us out, it was me and the congregation. One thing we might not know about Kay, she's a little bit of an introvert, but she loves people, so it's kind of an oxymoron. So, welcome, Dan and Kay. Welcome. So, the next person is going to be joining us online right now, Kelly Cunningham. So, we'll be sure to include bios and pictures in the Chronicle next month so that everyone can see the information again and match a face with a name. So, Kelly lived in Los Osos from 2000 to 2005. And then she moved back to her hometown of Kerman. And now she's back for good since 2017. Her interests and hobbies include anything to do with the water and the ocean. Swimming, boogie boarding, walking on the beach. And she also loves to talk with people. People are interesting, and she wants to hear people's stories. Kelly got connected with our church through Stephen Ministry. That's where she met Christy. And Christy invited her to go to church, and now she says it's her church too. So welcome, Kelly. Good morning, Kelly. Welcome. And then next, I'm going to invite up Jack and Karen Gould. So again, I'll stand 6 feet apart so that you can remove your mask if you would like. So Jack and Karen Gould have lived in the area for a total of 25 years. That's the total for their 3 stays here in San Luis Obispo. 22 years in SLO, the most recently, Atascadero before that, and then 2 years back in the 1960s. So I'll start with Jack, who is on my far right. Jack's interests and hobbies include reading, photography, and volunteering. And what brought Jack to our church? He likes that it's a small, Christ-centered church that reaches out to the community. And one thing that you might not know about Jack is that he got paid by the state to drive 150 miles per hour daily. Wow. So he must have been with the highway patrol or a NASCAR driver. I don't know. Welcome, Jack. And Karen here to my immediate right. Karen's interests and hobbies include traveling, gardening, reading, and mostly playing with dogs. And the picture that they sent is one of them with a little puppy. And what brought Karen to our church? Well, she lives nearby and passed almost daily the inspirational sign that she read every time she passed. One thing that you might not know about Karen is that she has ridden by mule up and down the 1,700-foot oceanside cliffs of Molokai. Wow. Twice. My goodness. Jack and Karen, welcome. Welcome. And now I'm going to invite Diane Steinberg Lewis and Kenny Lewis. So Kenny and Diane have been here almost every Sunday, recently helping with the music and the worship and helping us live stream. So thanks, you two. You are a blessing. You're a blessing. You don't have to stay 6 feet. You're married. For 44 years, I heard.
Try to set an example.
All right. So I will begin with Diane, who's on my immediate left. Diane and Kenny have lived in the area since 2006, and her interests and hobbies include music, swimming, and hiking, and however, most recently, politics. Whew, Lord have mercy. What brought Diane to our church? She has been here with concert groups, and on one occasion, she was asked to accompany vocalists. It might have been either Roz or Leslie. And one thing you might not know about Diane is that she was a recording artist. I believe it, hearing you every Sunday. Welcome, Diane. About Sergeant...
She's Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
And the Sergeant Pepper Lonely Hearts Club?
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. So she's a famous recording artist. And then let me introduce Kenny Lewis. So Kenny's interests and hobbies include music, fishing, cooking, gardening, and travel. And my goodness, if you've ever heard Kenny play bass, he plays bass on the really important days like Easter and Christmas. And then I can just focus on the rest of the service, which is a blessing. And it's a blessing to hear you play bass, Kenny, let me tell you. One day when I grow up, I hope to play bass like you. What brought you to our church? Well, his lovely wife, Diane, did. And what's one thing that we might not know about you? Kenny plays the Native American wooden flute. And maybe he can play that sometime here in the church. We'd love that. Yeah, for the holidays. We'd love that. So welcome, Diane and Kenny.
Yes.
And then now I'm going to invite Jan Mastery to come up. Welcome, Jan. So Jan has lived here since 2006, but she was born here and was raised in Santa Barbara. Her interests and hobbies include kids, horses, dogs, animals, traveling, cruising, and camping, and maybe chickens now. I think there's some chickens now. What brought Jan to our church? Well, her next-door neighbor at the time, Cynthia, invited her to church, and she was looking for a different kind of church at the time. Boy, did she find it. One thing you might not know about Jan is that she was a hospice nurse for 14 years, and it was her greatest passion. And we thank you for that service, Jan. And another thing that she shared is that she is a breast cancer survivor of 25 years. Jan. Jan, that is extraordinary. I'm so grateful. And welcome. So I'm going to ask all of you to be in covenant with us now. So Amy, Shell, Dan, Kay, Kelly, Jack, Karen, Diane, Kenny, and Jan. We are the descendants of people who came to this new world looking for religious and political freedom. The Congregationalists desire to live in a country without a king and worship in a church without a bishop. They believe that local congregations were capable of making important decisions all on their own. They desired to govern themselves and discern for themselves God's mission for them. In 1629, the Congregational Church that was founded in Salem, Massachusetts, entered into covenant with each other by declaring this: "We covenant with the Lord and with one another, and do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways, according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth." That was the Salem covenant. And so now I will ask you the San Luis Obispo covenant of 2020. Will you be in covenant with God and with one another? Will you live in awareness of God's presence in the world, in your neighbor, and in yourself? Will you continue Jesus' mission to love, serve, and heal here in San Luis Obispo County? Will you support this congregation with your presence, with your prayers, your gifts, and your service? If so, say, "We will." Then in the name of our Lord Jesus, I welcome you into this congregation. Welcome, friends. That is one of the greatest joys I have as your pastor, seeing our family grow. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to Richard, who's going to lead us in the call to worship and the opening prayer.
Good morning. What a wonderful All Saints morning. This is awesome. Let us all stand together in spirit for our call to worship. For all the saints who have gone before us, God, we give thanks for our ancestors in the faith. For all the saints who have been beloved by us, God, we give thanks for our loved ones who have passed on. For all the saints who have left us too soon, God, we mourn their passing, and they remain in our hearts. Amen. Now please join me in the opening prayer. On earth, in heaven, we are one. We are your children. We thank you for those who have gone before us. Help us remember that we are loved by the same God from this life into eternity. Amen.
Thank you.
Before our time of prayer and meditation, I'm going to read from Paul's first letter to the church at Thessalonica, 1 Thessalonians, and I'm going to read from verses 9 through 16. And this is maybe one of the first letters that would come to make up the New Testament. Paul writes, "You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day so that we might not burden any of you while we proclaimed to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was toward you believers. As you know, we dealt with each one of you like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. We also constantly give thanks to God for this, that when you received the word of God that you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as it really is, God's word, which is also at work in you believers. Amen." Loving God, on this day that we remember all of the saints, past and present, we pause to remember all of the beloved saints that we know. Those ones who are still with us. God, also the ones who are with you now, who have heard Jesus say to them, "Well done, good and faithful servant." God, help us remember them. We remember the saints who were part of our congregation who have passed recently. We remember Jim Wagner, Jim Breyer, and Everett Chandler, and Hope Casfelt. God, we don't despair because we know that they are with you, and yet we miss them. morning, God, we also pray for our world as it continues to struggle with this global pandemic. We see numbers surging again. So, God, we ask that you bless all of the nurses, the doctors, the scientists, the first responders, everyone who is tending to the sick right now. And God, also, we ask for your help. Remind us to do everything possible to keep people safe and healthy right now. It's a way of loving people. Wear a mask, wash our hands, practice social distancing. God, we also pray for our nation as we anticipate a challenging week filled with uncertainty. So many folks are just at fever pitch right now. We remember what President Lincoln once said. We are not enemies, but friends. Though passion may have strained, it must not break the bonds of affection. The mystic chords of memory will swell when again touched, as surely as they will be by the better angels of our nature. God, help us be better people. Help us love one another, even when we disagree. We lift up people who are beloved to us. We ask for healing and wholeness to be with Brett and with Ed and Sanja, for Vince and Keith, and everyone impacted by fires. We pray for the Mastery family.
Lift up Kenny, Sierra, Kendra, Taylor, all of those in our families. And we ask that, Lord, per your word, you said no weapon shall be formed against us. And we ask a special prayer of protection and peace on all of those who will be voting on Tuesday.
God, we thank you for Jesus, who has called us to be his disciples, who said, love God, love one another, everything else is a footnote. That's my translation. Love, we must love. We must not hate, we must not fear. We must choose love. And God, we lift up the prayer that he taught his first disciples when they said, how should we pray? He said, pray in this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 through 12. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, do whatever they teach you and follow it. But do not do as they do, for they do not practice what they teach. They tie up heavy burdens and hard to bear and lay them on the shoulders of others. But they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. They love to have the place of honor at banquets and the best seats in the synagogue and the place of honor and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have people call them rabbi. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all students. And call no one your father on earth, for you have one father, the one in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted."
Thank you, Richard. Who does this Jesus think he is? The religious elites must have wondered. Doesn't he know that we are the ones who speak for God and not him? Who does this guy think he is? We have ways of doing things that go all the way back to our people's time with Moses. We go all the way back to the time in the wilderness following the Exodus from Egypt. This Jesus has been critical of us and our way, and therefore he's been critical of God. He must be stopped, they thought. And they did their very best to stop him. If you listen, though, Jesus wasn't critical of their teaching. He told his disciples to listen to their teaching. Their teaching is good. They know what's right up here. They just don't do it. Don't make the same mistake as them, he told his disciples. Don't live the way they live. The religious elite's mistake was self-justification. They believed that they were righteous and holy because they were doing everything right. They were doing everything the way you should. They were just because they were obeying all of the rules. And my goodness, they had to let everyone know just how holy and righteous they were. They did all of their deeds just to be seen by others. And they wore special robes to let others know how holy they were. And they have the biggest phylacteries. Those are the little boxes that our Jewish friends wear that contain a piece of Scripture. They would have huge phylacteries to show, yes, Scripture was so important to me. They did all of this stuff to show others how holy and righteous they were. And, of course, they expected special privileges from others, because they were so holy. They expected a place of honor at banquets and the best seats in the synagogue. And they expected to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces. And they expected people to call them rabbi or teacher. And they expected people to say, ooh and ah, as they walked by. They expected to be rewarded for their holiness. Don't live like them, Jesus said. Don't expect to be called rabbi. Don't expect any special privileges. Don't expect to be esteemed by people. You are not here to satisfy the demands of your ego, the fragile ego that just demands more and more of your time and your energy and makes you the center of the universe. A friend recently said, "Your ego is not your amigo." I thought, my goodness, that's going up on the sign. That is too good. Your ego is not your amigo. There's part of us that says, I must be seen as strong and wise and righteous. That part of us is not our friend. It makes everything, including our friendships and our relationships, even our relationship with God, it makes all of that stuff all about us. We become the center of the universe. Jesus said, don't make your spirituality all about you and how people see you and what you can get from it. And Jesus told his first disciples that, and he tells us today that same thing. Rather, be humble. Have a humble heart. Remember that it is not all about you. Rather, faith, spirituality is about God's kingdom. It's about God's realm of peace and love and joy and abundance here and now. God's call on you to live in this realm, in God's realm, and to further this realm. Faith is about service and self-sacrifice, not self-justification. Faith is about what God has done in the past and what God is still doing today to heal and to transform this world. It's not about what you can get from God or others. It's not a means by which you can get a greater wealth or respect or privileges. This was a radical message in Jesus' day, and it's a radical message in our day. So many people approach faith with the mindset of what they can get. Wealth and good health. You've heard of the prosperity gospel, right? God wants everyone to be healthy and rich. Well, come on. It's not all about wealth and good health and respect. It's not even about eternal life. It's like some folks have a grocery list of things that they want, and God is just a useful way of getting all these things that they want. God is not just a way of you getting the things that you want. The ego is at the heart of this approach. That's the ego talking. It's not God. So don't be like that, Jesus said. Let God, who is love, not your ego, be at the heart of your approach to faith. And if you do that, you will be humble. You will act out of love and concern for others naturally. You won't be acting out of arrogance or a need to justify yourself. Now, acting out of love will cause you to be humble, not proud. It will cause you to serve, not want to be served. It will make God the center of your universe, not yourself, not your ego. Living with a humble heart leads to joy and compassion and grace. And it creates community where there are differences. Differences are welcomed and celebrated and not just tolerated. Humility creates space in us to welcome those who are different, to celebrate diversity. Humility recognizes that we are not the judge of others and that we are not the image to which all sentient beings must conform. We are one person who God has called to further God's realm, but we're not the only one. Humility creates a room for others. Isabel Carter Hayward said, "Genuine humility is a gift from God, which has nothing to do with downcast eyes, a misty voice, and noble stories of sacrifice. Humility is, rather, living courageously in a spirit of radical connectedness with others, which enables us to see ourselves as God sees us, sisters and brothers, each as deeply valued and worthy of respect as each other." Courage, radical connectedness, seeing each other as siblings, deeply valued and worthy of respect. This is the way that Jesus calls us to live. It's the way of the people of the way, which was the first name for Christians. Before we were called Christians, we were called people of the way. We recognize that there was a way of living that produced all the fruits of the Spirit, love, hope, joy, grace, peace, self-control. There was a certain way of living that created all of these things. And that's how Christians used to refer to themselves, the people who lived this way. I think we should dust off this name, people of the way. This was also the way of the early Congregationalists. And it's the way of so many of the saints in our congregation, both living and past. May God help us live with humble and not proud hearts. May God help us remember that the way of life and peace is self-sacrifice, not self-justification. May God help us remember that the way of life and peace is the way of the cross. May God help us remember that the way of joy is service, not expecting to be served. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted. Amen, Lord Jesus. Will you pray with me? Divine love, we thank you for this reminder to be humble, to remember that our ego is not our amigo, that you, God, and our neighbor are the center around which we must rotate, not expect others to rotate around us, especially God. We ask for humility. We ask that you help us be teachable, that we might live with joy and with peace. Amen. Friends, at this point, I invite you to think about sharing a gift with this congregation. And I want everyone to remember that there are a variety of gifts. There's financial gifts, but there's also gifts of service. Think about ways that you can share of yourself in order to support the mission, the ministries of this church, to help us love, do justice, and to walk humbly with God.
Praise God, one love we all may share. Praise God, one beauty everywhere. Praise God, one hope of good to be. Praise God, one faith that makes us free.
Gracious God, we are your people, and we carry your presence. Use us and our gifts to accomplish your mission in our world. Multiply our effort to meet every need. Amen.
Before we celebrate communion together, will you join me in singing, "Let Us Break Bread Together"? In our congregation, we celebrate the sacred meal that Jesus initiated with his very first followers on the first Sunday of every month, which happens to be today, which is All Saints Day. It's a very special time of communion. We remember that on the night in which Jesus gave himself up, he took the bread and he broke it, and he shared it with his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat this, all of you. This is the bread of life. This is the bread of humility. This is the bread of vulnerability, which will sustain you on your journey." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, he blessed it, and he shared it with his disciples, and he said, "Take and drink this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, which God enters into now with everyone, with Jew and Gentile, with female and male, with slave or free, with everything that has breath. God desires to be in covenant in communion with you. Will you pray with me? Loving God, we ask that you pour out your Spirit upon these humble gifts of the grape and the grain. God, whatever people have this morning here at church, it's grape juice and pita bread. But whatever people have at home, God, transform it into the bread of life and humility, and the cup of the covenant. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us join in the sacred meal together. For those of us here, I tried a new thing this month. I put a little plastic wrap over the bread because, gosh, that whole wheat pita bread dries out something fierce. I could barely talk after I ate it. So you might hear some saran wrap. We're trying something new. We're doing our best. The gifts of God for the people of God. Well, that was much better. Will you please pray with me? Eternal God, we give thanks that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And will you join me in singing A Million Saints? And please rise in body or in spirit.
My hands and say you're holy,
Amen. Now, beloved friends, let the light of God's love shine on you and in you and through you as you go out into the world to serve God's people. Go in peace. Amen. And I invite you to join me in saying the full serenity prayer, which comes from our good friend Reinhold Niebuhr. And he said, God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Accepting hardship, living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking, as Jesus did, the sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. God's beloved, stay healthy, stay safe. Remember to do everything you can to help stop the spread of the virus. We will get through this. Jesus promised us that. We will be together in our sanctuary. We will have 1 million saints, or at least 250, I think, is our maximum occupancy. We will be together one day. In the meantime, happy All Saints Day. I love you. I miss you. We'll see you next week. Now I'm going to put on my ugly mug ceramics mask.